All right, Alice, tell me what you think. Which band is better, Pearl Jam or Motley Crue?
I really don't know that I could name a song. That's from
the debate going on right now, and I have just because they're spatting. Eddie Vedder is going at it with Nikki Sixx. Whose cell phone number I have? Did you know that?
Oh wow, you must be like famous or something.
I was the male receptionist, and he just gave it to me. He's like, "Have her call me. This is my number."
Oh, and you saved it.
Yeah, I do have it somewhere. That's a keeper. I have a little black book of my receptionist days, and I got a lot of good numbers in there. I've got some. It's interesting because I've just wrote a bunch of stuff down, including the word. Did I ever show you it?
I don't know.
When I became the receptionist at Intercom,
mm-hmm.
which is after I left hotels and tried to get into radio. So I became the receptionist, and I wanted to be really good. So,
mm-hmm.
so I would. Write down. I wanted to remember everybody's name. So I remember I would write down. There was a woman named Kristen Weber who was very pretty and nice and fun. And I wanted to. So I wrote down her name and who she looked like, who was famous. Try to get them all down. But they're all in there. And it's interesting. It just reminds me of that crazy time. But I've also got in there, I've got a bunch of. I used to take complaints, of course, and people were always angry. Always angry. First of all, that we liquidated one of the stations and flipped it, and it had been an iconically gay friendly station, and so the fellows were not pleased when we flipped the station and were yelling at me.
Like you made the decision.
Like I made the decision. Like I'm just the guy who answers the phone here. But I actually have some early comments from listeners, including one. Saying a guy demanding that we cancel Jerry Callahan and John Dennis, and some of his comments. It's very cool. I should probably send it to Jerry. Jerry would like that, I think. Jerry, who I understand by looking at Twitter today, that Jerry and I are setting up a fund to bail out January 6 rioters.
Jerry and you are?
Yes. This is a Twitter lie said by these group of homeless virgins who are
really
trying to find a way probably to get to Jerry's sponsors or whatever. Thankfully, they won't get to our sponsors, will they?
They will not. Our sponsors
are
not reachable.
Right. And on the list of the multiple hundreds of millions of people I would be bailing out or fundraising for before January 6th rioters would be Thomas Shattuck to start with. So a couple of things. So you know, one, I think it's so pathetic just watching this battle go on here with Eddie Vedder and Pearl. First of all, very few good
songs.
So
what are they even mad at each other about?
Eddie Vedder said that the heavy metal sucked because it made the guys sound vacuous and stupid and portrayed the girls in a terrible light. And it was. Motley Crue sang about grabbing chicks and having sex. By and large, that was it. The boys in the band were jumping in the car, grabbing beautiful women and having a great time with them. That's as far as really as it gets. I'll take that every day over the pretense of whatever Jeremy has broken with all this crappy wailing stuff. That's Pearl Jam for you.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just spent the entire 90s doing his not real singing kind of thing, being deep. You know, my generation decided that we were the new deep generation. And so we were looking at Meaning Man in the early 90s. We were as pathetic as anything else, believe me. But I think
Gen X listened to some stupid Motley Crue metal also.
Well, yeah, a few years early, that's no doubt. But there was really in the early 90s an enlightenment, an alternative enlightenment, when we eschewed all of the pink lipstick and spandex pants stuff for grungy thoughtfulness, and we embraced our own angst. It's a good thing we didn't have TikTok. Oh my God, I would. Yeah, it's a good thing because we were pathetic. I mean, there was a time.
I think you guys turned out okay.
Well, I mean, we weren't
like some other generation.
Bat bleep crazy. We were just navel gazing, but there was a time like I remember when Eddie Vedder was talking about how it was unfair. This entire generation had had inherited the policies of Bush Reagan and like incurred a huge national debt and this and that. We found a way in 1991 to somehow make ourselves victims of really an ideal life. The entire 90s, nothing happened anywhere, but everybody but Tom Shattuck got rich and the world changed forever with the internet. It's like, please. But I dove into it. There was even a grunge cola called OK Cola. Did I tell you about this?
I don't think so.
OK Coca-Cola, because they could tell that you couldn't be commercial, couldn't be establishment. You had to be alt and part of the like cool intellectual fringe. That they had to launch a Coca-Cola launched an alternative cola, and it was called OK Cola. You know what? This cola is just okay. We don't even care, whatever, drink it or don't. Doesn't matter. That was it. The complacency was, and I of course bought the first six pack available. I'm like, oh, I'm Generation X. I'm supposed to buy this. It was delicious, actually. But that's beside the point.
Was it the same as regular Coke?
No. It was orangey. It was like an Orange Crush kind of thing. But it was okay, and there were like smart assy quotes on it, like, yeah, we don't care. We're so trying not to even have a good cola. Deal with it. It was very much on point with the time. There was with early 90s, Kurt Cobain was like, he doesn't give a flying F. He was like bitchy to all the MTV VJs who wanted to talk to him. He was moody. Oh, he didn't want to talk to any press. He'd brag about sometimes it's trying to go and buy the cheapest guitars he could find, like pieces of crap, and wouldn't even tune them right. Yeah. Because of the amount. It was very important you let everybody know that you didn't care. Yeah. So anyway. Wow. I don't know why I bring that up. But anyway, it was a
because Eddie Vedder and Nikki Sixx are in a fight.
Nikki Sixx are in a fight and Eddie Vedder in a fight. But it's now these are two middle-aged men, both of whom made their living as circus performers trying to out-cool each other. And it's just very interesting. To his credit, Nikki Sixx has died more than once, I think, and had been resuscitated.
Is that the one that got in the car accident, like drunk driving?
Vince Neil got in the car accident and killed somebody.
That's another Motley Crue person.
There's no doubt Nikki Sixx got into car accidents, too. Okay. And maybe he was in the car.
But that's the one that people know about. Okay.
Yes.
I think I saw part of a documentary on Motley Crue one time, like by accident.
No, we saw that thing about Tommy Lee. Remember the kid was pretended to be Tommy Lee and it like he's almost a first person thing. He said, oh, let me tell you how the crew started. And we saw it. We liked the movie. It was fun. But that said, there was a movie.
I don't think we're talking about the same thing.
Yes. Well, we saw the movie that stars a kid who played Tommy Lee who talked about his like life experience. And we liked the movie. In that movie, it includes the car crash. Mm-hmm. Because the Motley Crue was down the street or whatever.
I don't know.
But it is interesting. Just another thing for the 90s before we move on from this. This new show that's on about Pam Anderson and Tommy Lee.
Yeah.
I don't see how that could possibly be a draw.
Well, not only that, but the people who are like fans of Pam Anderson, who I guess exist, don't want to see it because she's upset about it because they did it without her permission or her blessing or anything. And like, they feel that it's re-traumatizing her from
what?
The trauma of
re-traumatizing
the...
her.
Yes.
So here's my thing about that. The real Pam and Tommy were more spectacular than those two. What are you going to do? The real Pam had sex on camera for the world to see and was a total knockout.
Well, apparently she was traumatized because it was leaked, and this is re-traumatizing her.
What was the sex tape, the Pan and Tommy sex tape? Right, yeah. She was traumatized, all right. But like, those two lived a very wild, very public life. Like, we've already seen everything that this thing could show us. What's he going to hit her now? I think we know that happens. It's like,
well, I think people are... I mean, I think people like movies where people pretend to be other people. As do as
do
we. We watch. We enjoy
Pamela Anderson, or Pamela Sue Anderson, as she was once known. I think Pamela Anderson, Alice, in the 1990s. Let's say 1990 through 1999. I would say those were pretty good years for her. And I would say that she probably was treated like a royal and had a good time.
Okay.
So what is her hang up? What is her problem now? What is her new
she
drama?
She was traumatized because her sex tape was leaked.
Yeah. Yeah. That's I remember the
narrative amongst my contemporaries, yeah. I can tell you. So it's that's so like, because I saw somebody post, like, I can't believe they're even allowed to do this without her permission.
Do you know what
it's incredible. And all the comments are like, I can't believe they would re-traumatize her like this.
The sex tape
was
leaked 25 years ago.
Well, no, but the documentary is portraying all the events again without her permission. So that's like why people feel it's sort of invasive and not right.
You know what percentage of just between us, because we're in love, sex tapes leak, Alice?
100.
Correct. There is not. There are zero that haven't leaked. And even if you think, and I, between you and I, Alice,
mm-hmm.
I dated somebody in the 2000s who had been allowed her very close boyfriend to film a romance with her.
No.
Oh, yeah. I didn't tell you this?
I don't think so.
And
why would you ever let anyone, ever?
Right. Okay. So I'm sure that there is, like, in Denmark, she is world famous and has no idea. You know, I didn't bother to look around. But, like, this, and she said, oh, no, there's no way he'd show anybody. So what I assume is that women just, what they're saying is subliminally, yeah, I know it's going to be leaked, and I kind of want it to be leaked. Because other than that.
I don't think, I think a lot of women are very naive about, like, men.
Do you realize? Yeah, I guess they would be. I guess it would be. Because the first thing, okay, I'm not, I will just say, ooh, is that coyotes?
No, it's our neighbor's dog.
The little one or the big one?
The deep bark is the big one, and the little are bark both of them out is there? The old one. Yeah, they're both out there.
I want to see some coyotes. Okay, so other things going on. There is a story that's getting lots of play today about, and we can relate to this, Alice, about, did you see it in Lenore Skenazy in Reason Magazine? About a mother who got in trouble because she let her daughter babysit. Her daughter was 14, and the mother got a working from home job, and the daughter, the 14-year-old, was supposed to be watching the kid.
Mm-hmm.
And the kid got outside,
uh-huh.
Right? And a neighbor saw the kid outside. Supposedly the kid was either half-dressed or not dressed.
Okay.
Imagine this happening all as well.
I can't the kid somehow managed this ever to happening.
No, right. Escape outside. And guess what the neighbor did?
Called the police.
Absolutely. The neighbor called the cops on them. And now the mom is in deep kimchi and she's had all sorts of stuff. And the 14-year-old now can't babysit anymore because supposedly there could be a developmental problem that the 14-year-old has that someone somewhere, some government stooge has unearthed, whatever. So anyway, it just reminded me, obviously, of our own experiences.
There's plenty of really
good citizens who were happy to show us that we have dropped the ball and then immediately afterwards call the police on us.
Yeah. There's plenty of people who are over 18 who let kids escape. And even people who, like, work for daycare centers and are supposedly trained to work with kids in the safest possible environment and let kids die all the time. I think your kid is safer in your house with your own teenager watching them. And the mom was there. She was working from home. And she was physically there.
Yes.
But not paying attention because she was working. And the kid got out. I mean, that's pretty, like... yeah. It's hard for me to imagine, like, a world in which that should be illegal.
Here we go. This is Lenore Skenazy, who we love, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is a very pretty young family. Mom handcuffed, jailed for letting 14-year-old babysit kids during COVID-19. I almost don't have words for how this made me feel, says Melissa Henderson. When COVID-19 shut down her children's daycare in May of 2020 and Melissa Henderson had to go to work, she asked her 14-year-old daughter, Lindley, to babysit the four younger siblings. Lindley was engaged in remote learning when her youngest brother, 4-year-old Thaddeus, spied his friend.
Okay, so mom wasn't working from home. The sister was doing schoolwork from home.
Okay.
The mom wasn't there.
Okay.
But still.
When she asked a 14-year-old to babysit the four younger siblings, Lindley was engaged in remote learning when her youngest brother, 4-year-old Thaddeus, spied his friend outside and went over to play with him. It was about 10 or 15 minutes late before Lindley realized he was missing. She guessed that he must be at his friend's house and went to fetch him. In the meantime, the friend's mom had called the police. What a witch. Now Henderson, a single mom in Blairsville, Georgia, is facing criminal reckless conduct charges for letting her 14-year-old babysit.
How is that illegal? Because
12-year-olds babysitted me and my brother.
Yeah, definitely. There was a babysitting course at my sixth grade. It was like an after-school course you could take that was like an extracurricular, and you could learn like CPR and be like a qualified babysitter,
right.
Like learn what to do if the smoke alarm goes off or whatever. And that was like considered normal that 12-year-olds would take a babysitting class or like have younger siblings and then be a babysitter at 12. That
right.
was like... Just people just did that.
She is facing criminal reckless conduct charges for letting her 14-year-old babysit. The charges carry a maximum penalty of 1 year in prison and a fine of $1,000. The arresting officer, get this, Deputy Sheriff Mark Pelote, wrote in his report that anything terrible could have happened to Thaddeus.
Oh, I love that one.
Yep.
That's what we've heard, too, when people complain that our kids were outside without us.
Yep, including being kidnapped, run over, or bitten by a venomous snake. When Henderson protested
they could have been struck by lightning.
Yep. When Henderson protested that the kid was only gone for a few minutes, Pelote responded that a few minutes was all the time a venomous snake needed. There's a photo attached that shows the busy street and the jungle-like conditions that Thaddeus faced. And it's a wide open, very private road. It's like farmland. There's one house here and one house a quarter of a mile away. Nobody on the road. It's wide open.
I hate people so much. Mm-hmm. What's wrong with people? What would possess you to call the cops on your neighbor with their kids? I mean, like, I can't. There would have to be, like, cigarette burns on a kid before I would call the police on the parents.
I just don't understand.
Like, what? Why,
oh,
like,
I know.
Normal parenting, like, kid runs outside things are... We're like criminalizing them,
right?
Because that's insane. And a 14-year-old babysitting is completely normal. It's normal,
right? And sometimes kids get outside. Okay, it's nice to live on a dead end road where there's no. My neighbor was naked running around his house for like 2 straight years. But we live in a dead end, without any informers.
So there weren't people driving by who were gonna call the police,
right? But, you know, near our house, we have a convention of people who need to let us know every time and then give us crap. Henderson, the woman, had been investigated by the Georgia Division of Family and Children's Services about a year earlier when Thaddeus, age 3 at the time, had also wandered outside. She was no longer under DFS supervision when the second incident occurred. DFCS investigated Henderson's conduct this time around and found it unexceptional. Case closed. But Pelote recalled the earlier investigation, believing this proved some sort of pattern. He initiated the arrest about 2 weeks later. 5 cop cars came to her house, Henderson tells Reason.
I thought you weren't allowed to convict people on the basis of previous bad behavior. I thought you, like, literally weren't allowed to...
She says, I almost don't have any words for how low it made me feel, she says, to truly feel in the bottom of my heart that if I'm... anything, it's a good mother, and everything you do is for your kids. To be stripped of that to the point where you are handcuffed in front of them. She was placed inside a police cruiser and taken to county jail, where she was photographed, fingerprinted, and even given a pair of bright orange Crocs to wear. Then she was put in a cell. I remember curling up in the ball in the corner and just wanting to hide, she said. Her ex-husband bailed her out. Can you imagine the feeling that would be, just having been separated from your kids, knowing they're at your house, and you're in this with... These ridiculous.
And now how is anybody better off? How were the kids better off that they brought her to jail?
Right.
Like, it doesn't help anyone. And it's incredible because it really also is another way in which being, and this is something to their credit the left does talk about sometimes, in particular when it affects people of color, but they do bring it up, how, like, being poor ends up being criminalized. Like, if you can afford an expensive nanny, then you won't be in trouble, but if you have your 14-year-old babysit, well, you're screwed, you know? And, like, a lot of these stories of parents like this who get arrested because they're, like, at work and they let their kid go play at the playground down the street... A lot of times it is poorer people. A lot of times it is people who work at McDonald's or somewhere where they, like, have a shift and they have to physically be there. They can't remote work. They can't hire a nanny. They're not making enough money. And And it really is, like, where the system is judging you and saying you're not good enough because you didn't have money to do it how we, the expensive rich people who live in Wellesley, do it, which is we hire expensive nannies, you know?
Right.
Like, just be rich next time, stupid. I mean, that's the message, right? The message is don't have a job where you have to leave, where you can't afford to pay a babysitter if you're schools all close on you because the government sucks. You know,
that's
the message. And that's the message about a lot of things too, right? Like, for example, one of our two cars, and I won't say which one because I don't want to say we would ever break any laws ever, has an expired inspection sticker. And it costs money to fix the thing that would keep it from passing inspection. So you end up delaying getting the inspection sticker because you can't afford to fix the thing that gets it to pass inspection. And then, you know, then you get in trouble and you get a ticket for driving around with an expired inspection sticker. So it's like, again, you know, the lesson is next time don't be poor, right?
Right. Well, but I feel terrible. And obviously we've had our own money challenges and everybody does, you know. But I feel terrible. Like, this woman, how many days of work did she miss? How many days did she get docked pay?
As far as tickets go,
like, you don't get a break, especially if you've got to drive to work and you get 6 parking tickets. And that's your day's pay is gone. It's like,
right.
It is vicious. This right. is why government is so
freaking. And if they're late, they charge you more.
Right.
And then they put a boot on your car. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, like, it just, like, snowballs and escalates. And the answer to everything is like, well, just don't be poor next time. Sucks to be you.
But meanwhile, the people saying that want their college tuition to be paid to them.
I know. But there's 1,000 things like that. And if you ever, like, struggle with money, you always bump up against this. That, like, you always end up getting punished for not, like, having money. And nowhere is it more apparent than with parenting.
Oh, right? And that was, like, terrible. Remember, just being a young guy and, like, getting overdraft fees so much to the point where I was getting overdraft fees hit so much that, like, my next paycheck was already gone. It's like, it's a sinking, horrible feeling. It's a terrible feeling. I feel terrible for people who are mired in that crap right now. It's like, geez. And this woman, raising 4-5 kids is enough of a pain. Now she's got to worry about some damn ratty neighbors who are called the cops?
Yeah, and she has to deal with the court case and the DCFS investigation and everything else, which will also cost her money and time, possibly cost her job, because some jobs don't put up with that, right? Like, some jobs, if you get arrested, are like, sorry, we're done with you, you know? And it's incredible, like, penalties that are on parents who are just, like, trying to survive for, you know, their choices being judged by other people who aren't in their shoes and don't and have different options than they do. You know, that's what sucks about it, right? And it doesn't make anybody's life better. Like, what really are they going to do? If they take away those kids and put them in foster care, are they going to be having a better life? How many kids in the foster care system escape from the house or get mauled by pit bulls or get abused or whatever else, right? Like, it's so absurd. The idea is so absurd that any of this, like, as far as I'm concerned, we can just, like, disband that whole section of the government, the part that goes after parents, because it's garbage.
Agreed. All right, Alice, I'm going to get your take on this new movie coming out.
I think what annoys me most about white people is when they pretend like they're the victim.
Good song.
What's also annoying is when they, you know, when they kill us.
What is fragile about whiteness when everything has been constructed around it?
Every part of who I am has been distorted or criminalized.
Linda
Sarsour. It's really just a bunch of white lies.
Storming the Capitol!
You're not patriots. You're ridiculous.
Margaret Cho.
One of the definitions of American whiteness is ignorance.
White people, we are not your problem. You are.
Should white people today feel any responsibility for slavery?
Hell yeah.
White Jesus.
How does that work exactly? How exactly do I have a responsibility for slavery? Where does that come from? Yeah. How did I retroactively get in on that? It didn't seem to make any money doing it. Hell yeah. Does anybody have any agency for anything?
No, nobody's responsible for anything.
It's remarkable. Mm-hmm. It's remarkable. So here's a movie.
The only things you're responsible for are things you absolutely didn't do that happened 100 years before you were born.
So this is a movie which is just explicitly tearing down people based on their race.
Right.
How problematic white people are. It's a nice, timely thing, too. You know. God forbid we start to get a little better. And this, like, let me tell you something. This white people's tears and white people are killing us and all this and white people in this and white people in that and white people in this. It's not just, this isn't like we're being roasted now by comedians. This is manifesting itself in real stuff now.
Oh, yeah.
These people believe in critical race theory. There's no doubt they do. Mm-hmm. They believe in, certainly, if I'm sure some of them believe in black supremacy, whatever. Mm-hmm. But these people say this stuff, have these thoughts. I wouldn't want my kids hanging out with anybody who talked like this.
No. And as a matter of fact, I kind of want my kids to watch the movie to understand what's out there and how people are going to view them because of their race.
Remarkable.
Because
this is a black kid.
I want my kids to grow up knowing that there are people out there that are absolutely trying to go after them.
Well, yeah, and I'd say especially, but not only, but especially the boys.
Hell yeah.
White Jesus or black Jesus?
Jesus was not white.
Think of geography. Ain't no way Jesus walked around with blonde hair and blue eyes.
So this is my feeling on this, and I understand this is something that's supposed to be a great dunk.
Yeah.
You know? I would say that if you're trying to needle or razz somebody or insult somebody by doing what you think is probably dear to them, the iconic image of Jesus, and telling them that's fraudulent, it's actually very different, and Jesus belongs to another group more than it belongs to your group, then I don't know if that's really Christian.
Well, it's also stupid because, I mean, the earliest depictions of Jesus that we have, right, that are like from that still exist today, you know, date from like a couple hundred years after Jesus lived, but they typically are from the greater Middle East area, like Turkey. And they're, you know, they depict somebody who it looks essentially Middle Eastern, like is pretty fair skinned, but has dark hair, dark eyes, like looks, you know, like you would expect, basically a Semitic person. And then when it spreads further to other areas, other people depict what's familiar to them. Mm-hmm. So you have depictions of Jesus in Asia that look more Asian, and you have depictions of Jesus in Western Europe that look more Western European and fairer and has lighter hair and eyes. I mean, like, that's what all the people did everywhere. So that's not really like some big shocking thing.
White culture fears the end of the world. For us as Native people, the end of the world already happened, like, multiple times.
It's like, what if we took critical race theory and made it a totally fun, hip, edgy movie?
For us Native people, the end of the world already, like, happened a number of times. It did? I swear, that guy's sitting right there.
I know, it seems
sitting
like
right there. He's living in a big, non-Native American traditional dwelling. Wearing Western clothes.
Correct.
Getting fat off of Western food. Mm-hmm. You know, taking a piece of the Western economy. It seems to me he just started living.
You could be living your life in a happy, healthy way if you wanted to.
Symbols and monuments. These are mementos of racism. Oh. Remember that, that.
What about TCBY yogurt or something? Everybody can get behind.
The truth has
the strength of the trailer and the tracks and the dissing that's going on tells me that this is not going to be a great movie.
To be told about history.
We have to make sure that these stories
it says from the POC point of view, from the people of color point of view. Are people of color new here? I think that we've been
definitely
hearing
about not
the...
represented in pop culture at all, I think.
Well, not just that, but we've been hearing about the people of color. These are fellow Americans, by and large, for 400 years. We're very familiar with this.
Right.
And the struggle and everything that went into it and the big war we had where a bunch of teenagers from cold states fought a bunch of teenagers from warm states and slaughtered each other. Tore the country apart. I mean, this is why we think these people putting this film together, I'm sure it's just some producers who are like, this is where the winds are blowing here. Let's make some money. This generation of Americans here involved in this.
Mm-hmm.
Not only more clueless than other generations, but they think they're the most enlightened. And also, they're just a bunch of spoiled brats. spoiled brats. The American experience, especially in the last 30 years, for all Americans,
mm-hmm.
I wish they'd stop killing us.
Yeah. Now, I want to ask you this. What are the chances that that movie will be shown in any high school classrooms by a very cool history teacher?
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah, well, it's also going to probably clean up in whatever award shows there are now. A movie that tells you how bad the majority of people in the country, white people, how bad they suck.
Are told from our perspective.
There's always hope. You know what I'm saying? We don't give up.
It's about obliterating systemic and institutionalized racism.
Sounds fine. Eliminating the systemic and institutionalized racism until you realize that white people existing is part of the systemic and institutionalized racism.
Well, not only that, but I mean, to be honest here, I'm going to just go out on a limb
mm-hmm.
and say that Larry Elder will not be depicted in this.
Of course
and,
not. You think Candace Owens will be asked her opinion?
Right? Or Ben... the former secretary of the HUD, Secretary Ben Carson, mm-hmm. who's actually done extraordinary things in the medical field. It'd be interesting to hear from him. This is just more progressive bull.
Do you think they'll ask Clarence Thomas what he thinks? He's
no.
an incredibly accomplished person.
Anita Hill's
color.
Probably in it. You better believe that. This is just.
Did you see, by the way, something? I saw something like somebody was saying Biden should talk to Anita Hill before selecting his new Supreme Court justice.
Yeah.
How'd that go?
Right now, Biden is working with his HHS to give money to grants, which are going to fund free crack pipes and open injection sites.
Oh, good. We know that always works.
Yes. Yeah. Talk about... Maybe, guys, when you're talking about how bad the whites are, maybe you should be looking at their funding crack pipes as little warmer to the core of systems that are underserving people.
You would think that that would be on the agenda, but instead, no. I mean, I've even seen some people say that like the crack pipe thing is because of racial equity.
Right.
That like we do safe injection sites for heroin and we should do safe crack pipe sites or something. I don't know. That's insanity. It's insanity. Didn't work in Massachusetts. Andrew Lelling stopped that, I'm pretty sure, didn't he?
I think that he indicated that he would...
He would prosecute the
right.
people, yeah.
I think he indicated that. But who knows? It's going to happen now with Michelle Wu and the...
Well,
the
rumors that Andrew Lelling... I keep hearing sort of flutterings that Andrew Lelling might potentially run for governor.
He can't.
Why?
Well, he can, but he can't win. Because he's mean, Alice. Not like the last guy. The guy, not like Charlie Baker. He's a mean Andrew Lelling.
He's
Lelling.
Not Jeff Deal.
Well,
and
well.
he's been going on all the shows and like condemning January 6th.
And we actually did see a good
glowing profile
piece.
Of him. So
maybe something's up.
So I do kind of feel like he would be a good choice, like for like I don't know if Charlie Baker would have gotten out of the race if there wasn't someone ready to take the mantle of like the moderate Republican that the establishment likes. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And Karen Polito's not running. So like, who is that person? Like what possible person is there in this state who has the credibility to run for governor as a moderate Republican?
Richard Tessay? He's over, right?
I don't know. He's interested anymore. Yeah. Frankly, he has a good gig. I've seen his office. It's fancy. It's fancy office. I wouldn't leave that office.
All right, Alice. There is a viral tweet out there today.
Mm-hmm.
Put out there by America's favorite new dad, Chasten Buttigieg.
Okay.
Who has tweeted out, "When did you know you were straight?" And so people are retweeting this and tweeting pictures of Linda Carter, etc. Do you want to go first? First of all, are you straight?
Yes.
Okay. Why do you say it with a laugh?
I don't know. I would hope that you would know that.
Mm-hmm.
But thank you for not assuming. I appreciate that you're open-minded. Well, you're at the age
where girls were in college like lesbians for a month, I think. There was a lesbian until graduation, right?
Mm-hmm.
L-I-G, is that what that is?
L-U-G, until it's spelled with a U.
Oh, sorry. That's, you know what? Let me Google it.
Okay.
So spelled with a U. It is. Has it always been?
Yeah.
Oh, damn.
One of my favorite Tom stories is one of the kids brought something downstairs and he said, Dad, look, I bring you this. And you said, Sally, dear, it's brung.
It is brung. And I stand by that. Okay. Brung. Yes. Yes. I stand by that. It is brung. All right. So, what was your first crush? When did you know that you were a hetero cisgendered, birthing person?
Well, I don't know that I knew when I was a little kid that, like, I don't know. Like, when did I first like a boy?
When did you know? Answer the question, Chasten, please.
I don't know. Like, I probably had a crush on a boy in, like, fourth grade.
On an actual boy, not like a...
No, like a boy in my class.
Hold on, Alice.
When did you know?
I'm about to tell you.
But I didn't... Oh, do you know who I had a crush on for a while? I don't know if it's the very first person I had a crush on, like, in a book. If that's what we're doing. Because I didn't, like, watch much TV or whatever to, like, have a crush on a TV person. But I read a lot of books, surprisingly. And did you ever read the Redwall books?
No.
They're, like, about mice and stuff. And they live in this abbey. And, like, they're, like, anthropomorphic. Like, mice and badgers. And, like, they defend the abbey from, like, evil weasels and stuff. And one of them was called Martin the Warrior. And I really liked the mouse Martin the Warrior. He was pretty cool.
Okay.
I liked him. So I had a crush on a mouse. What sexuality is that, honey?
It makes sense for you. Okay. All right. So I think for me, Alice, I may have the time for you. I think I have the time for you. I think I'm going to try to play it here, okay?
Okay.
I think... Hold on. It is this time. This is probably somewhere around 1970 and then 9. And I think, if I'm not right, that if I'm not wrong, that it was. I thought it was the Charlie's Angels where they dress up as Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders. Now it looks like they were the sexy satin cheerleaders.
Oh.
And so...
44? Oh, well, see, I mostly just hung out with the younger crowd.
I suppose you're...
So there we go. I think that was it. Or it might have been BJ and the Bear, which is a trucker movie.
Okay.
Which is... I'm reminded by a commentary podcast, truckers were... Where there were the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders were on the episode, and something affected me certainly. Well, I mean, not in a gross way, but just okay. So they were mentioning about the trucker cultural thing.
Yeah.
From the 70s was a huge thing.
Yeah, there was, like, movies and stuff.
Well, all sorts of movies where you escape the cops, etc., and how, like, this new Canada trucker culture thing might be the resurgence of this, which is kind of cool. And I had forgotten that the CB radio was something that came out there. We had somebody who grabbed a CB radio and brought it to our house. A babysitter who was probably abusive to us, now that I think about it. But that big trucker stuff was really cool. And it was really like good old American, almost frontiersy. And you just to eschew the law was very cool. And I welcome it back. What do you think of the French truckers?
The Canadian truckers?
Yeah.
I mean, I like them. I think they're good.
I think the whole thing is wonderful to watch. Because all I'm seeing is, and I don't even know like the granular issues at play, but I'm seeing an effete dickhead in Trudeau look down at people and then have these guys pull off the impossible, and their movement's still growing, and he skips off and escapes and hides.
Right. Well, right, and they're actually, like, disrupting life quite a bit, which we got told quite a lot from people on the left is the whole point of protest is to disrupt life until you get noticed.
There's trouble in the streets.
Yeah, there needs to be unrest in the streets until as long as there's unrest in our hearts, right?
Yep.
So, there you go. If you have unrest in your heart, you are welcome to make unrest for everybody else all the time. That's what the left taught us, so now we're doing it. But, you know, of course, the rules are different for the left. So I assume some of these people are going to probably be in trouble because they're already comparing it to January 6th. And as I mentioned yesterday, you know, they're going after them, calling them racists and neo-Nazis. And they have this conspiracy theory that honk honk is secret code for Heil Hitler.
That's right.
So it's like a whole thing there. They've invented this whole narrative that like there's this secret Nazi movement that, you know, caused January 6th and is making the truckers go. It couldn't be that people don't like their stupid policies. That couldn't just be the case, that their policies suck and make people so angry that they're willing to disrupt their lives. That couldn't be it, you know. But the thing is, the left gets to occupy cities and even get people killed while occupying cities and have no repercussions or consequences to their movement or to the politicians who supported it whatsoever. There's no accountability on the left for any of that stuff. They 100% back everything other people on the left do, even if it's completely destructive. On the other hand, if you so much as, you know, like, don't vote for killing the filibuster to ram through Joe Biden's agenda, you're an enemy of the people. And anything goes as far as ruining and destroying you. You know, if you let people go on your podcast who say something that Biden says isn't true, then you need to be destroyed. We're going to dig through every word that you've ever spoken in your life and make sure we find something that can ruin you. You know, if you're Kyrsten Sinema, we can follow you into a bathroom. We can harass you. Gawker, I mentioned this in passing yesterday, but they wrote a whole piece entitled We Have Kyrsten Sinema's social security number, and the subhead of the piece is what do you think? Her social security number.
Wow, what ghouls, huh? Wow.
Last month, we filed a public records request for Arizona Senator Kyrsten Sinema's divorce papers. The request came back with many enlightening insights, such as that the congresswoman who wrote the book Unite and Conquer, How to Build Coalitions That Win and Last, and then declined to unite with her colleagues in passing the Build Back Better legislation that would have funded climate and social benefit infrastructure. That's quite an aside. She kept her 1997 Nissan Maxima SE when she divided and conquered her marriage in 1999. What's wrong with a 1997 Nissan Maxima SE?
I don't think
in anything. 1999, I don't know. The records also included some other intriguing information. Specifically, they included Sinema's social security number, bank account information, and driver's license number. It's possible she has since changed one or more of these. Typically, documents requested through open records law come with sensitive personal information redacted, but in this case, the inclusion of the personal information was not a clerical error. We checked. Because the documents were filed in 1999, they were not subject to the county's current secure system for storing confidential personal information. And because the public records regulations make legal documents much more accessible than those in supposedly liberal states like California or New York, the clerk's office was under no obligation to redact that information without a court order. Oh, good. So they didn't have to. They can just give it to Gawker. Perfect. The fallout is that anyone modestly familiar with navigating legal databases can obtain a U.S. Senator's Social Security number for $11 in processing fees. Huh. They go on to say that that you can do a lot with a Social Security number, but unfortunately, if the number in question isn't yours, most of what you can do with it is a felony. For example, we were hoping to run a credit check on cinema, but it seems to be illegal if you are not a business or individual qualifying for a person for a job, insurance, government benefits, or tenancy. One might argue that any of cinema's voting constituents are qualifying her for a job, but none of us is registered to vote in Arizona. Really? It's incredible that they're even, like, spitballing about this, isn't it?
Of course.
That they want a way to run a credit check on her because they have her Social Security number, so they're trying to find some workaround so that they can do it.
It's really terrorism.
It's bizarre, and it's, like, the whole article is an extended threat.
Stacey Abrams has apologized, Alice, for taking those pictures with the kids and what she had called a racist attack just 2 days ago. She now says it was a mistake, that she would set the right example as governor and wear a mask but not be a hardline if conditions change. It's too beautiful. It is too. All of these pictures, all of which found their way to Clay Travis, that show mm-hmm. Stacey Abrams in the classroom, all of the kids made to mask but not her in any picture. It is too beautiful. Breaking news, Alberta, which is my grandmother's name, who's from Canada. It's also a province in Canada. Alberta is dropping COVID restrictions and mandates. Threat of COVID-19 to public health no longer outweighs the hugely damaging impact of health restrictions. COVID and the restrictions have robbed thousands of young kids of the simple joys of being kids. Well, damn, that sure does it.
That's well, nice. More and more states are dropping
these
them,
truckers
right?
are about to be freaking going global tour. Oh my God.
Well, they're not thrown into jail in Canada. But all these states now are dropping them. Connecticut's dropped them. I mean, it's up to the local school districts, too. But you've heard it from Leanna Wen, who goes on TV and says that they need to drop the restrictions now because people are getting too non-compliant. Right. And they have to preserve their public health authority
for
later.
And the science has changed,
for later
says.
When they're going to do it. No, yeah. Well, the science is the public health science that says she wants to preserve the public health authority to do it again later. So she wants to make sure that people don't completely ruin the authority of the government to order you to wear a mask later, which is what should happen.
Damn it. Even Melrose, moving on from the mask mandate, Alice. And I have a new free subscription to my Substack, which means I better write one tomorrow. Oh, my goodness. I can't believe it, Alice. My goodness. All right, doggy, you good?
I'm good.
All right, everybody. I can't wait. We'll see you tomorrow. We'll see. I get the feeling something big's happening tomorrow. You heard it here first. Where did
Why
you
do
hear...
you feel that?
I'm not saying for us.
Why
I'm
do
just
you
saying feel... in world events. I just have a feeling. It just seems like the table was set today to have something drop tomorrow.
Okay.
Wednesday, Alice. All right, call it hump day.
Thank you again so much, everybody, for listening. You can find us at burnbarrelpodcast.com. We are at burnbarrelpod on Twitter, or you can find us at facebook.com/burnbarrelpodcast. We're also on YouTube for the moment. We are always on Rumble. They have claim they will not kick us off. And you can email us burnbarrelpodcast@gmail.com. C'est la vie.